We're running a bit late. Couldn't yell at Sam for being late. So we may drag lunch a little bit. There'll probably be food left by the time we get out. This is Ike. He's from New York. He's not particularly dangerous, despite this. And he's going to talk about jails. It's a very impressive talk. I have heard it in Canada. So look forward to a really good show.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, you guys, for having me here. It's an incredible pleasure to be speaking amongst all these fantastic developers. And so that you guys know who I am, you just gave it a good interview. A good intro. I am from New York. I, in this room, am a user. In other rooms, I'm a developer. In this room, I'm seriously a user. And I use jails extensively for web application servers and software development purposes. You know, I've been in and out of jails for years. I'm not going to get into any religious OS virtualization bashing, but I do have some really strong points to make based on specific threat model that has been the majority of my work, which are running production servers on the internet, which is a wonderfully violent and fun place to be. Let me see. A lot of information for an hour, and the ghost of Sam has made that less. So, questions after, please. You can move really fast. A lot of visual information, a lot of other information. I'll be around later, of course. Also, I'm trying to stay very close to classic UNIX processes, ideas, and stock methodology. All right? I'm a real fan history. I'm a real fan of not doing things out of the sake of just pure tradition, but traditions and patterns. Things come back for a reason. Things persist for a reason. And even in a lot of cases in my experience, those reasons aren't immediately evident. They often make themselves so at time or at scale. So I'm going to try to keep this all very stock. I'm not really presenting anything that's not stuff. No craziness. I also assume you know the basics of UNIX and perhaps FreeBSD jail, but regardless, I have spoken about jail in a lot of different places in different contexts before. And the last one, some of you were around it, nobody in the room, if you're elsewhere, if you were in Tokyo, but I spoke about jailing servers and compared them directly to, you know, buildings in my city. Talked about comparing PHK to Otis and an Otis elevator. I talked a lot about the growth of cities and how that's very much linked to the growth of the internet and how these patterns are similar. And I tend to think of the internet and internet service providers as very much becoming like cities. I live in a great city. I live in a crazy city. It's always changing, and it really has influenced my work with jails. But that's not this talk. This is a big overview. So we're going to start with an exercise that's about scale and patterns and complexity. Although, if any of you have ever seen the Ames movie, The Powers of 10, great film, 1977, Charles Ray Ames. And in this film, they start with this guy sleeping. The film is just a movie about a guy sleeping on a blanket in Chicago, Illinois. And they zoom all the way out in these intervals of powers of 10, way out into the universe, further than I even show here. And then they start zooming back in, and it's, they get into past DNA, and, all molecules and quarks. It's pretty fun stuff. If you haven't seen it, it's terrific. And there's patterns that emerge at all these different levels of scale in this movie. And there's other patterns that emerge. This is something similar. This is like my Ike little version of the universe here. And we start way out at the big end of it, and here's the internet, and we've got satellites, and somewhere in the GPS, clock timers, and fun things. We start scaling into the net, and I'm going to start scaling in towards my home in New York. And we slide past an ice book meeting, we slide into a data center, and the bowels of, a lot of us in this room know what data centers look like.
And we get into the data center, we get into the cabinets, we get into the machines and switches, and there's a guy sleeping, and I'm doing, I'm sure, we're out. We get to servers, the stuff we all touch, you know, very well, and hardware we know well, and what happens on the network ports, and the software that runs behind these ports, these actual physical interfaces. And this is where we get to BSD UNIX. And inside, we have all these daemons running these various applications. And behind that, we may have all these other application servers doing all kinds of wild things. And this little guy, just if you see these around, they might have been on my clothing, but you gotta say BSDs, they're everywhere. And it runs at BSD UNIX. All of this stuff, just to post, just to make a web page happen. Pretty astounding. You look at it at that scale. And there's more formal versions of looking at all of these layers, like, you know, the OSI model. We all know this stuff. But I like my version better. And I'm not going to talk about hardware much, because we all know it's getting faster, cheaper, smaller. The same things in the match head, those are embedded web servers. You that take up. So, UNIX. This is what we're here for today. This is my little diagram of UNIX. And it looks awful complicated at first glance, but you know, you can kind of see the devices over here, the kernel, and the rest of user land. This is a simpler kind of view of UNIX as we're going to need it to look at it today. You know, you can take this view of UNIX and think of it as something that's really complex. People like, I don't know if you guys caught Brooks' talk yesterday. But some people need to think of the computers as very simple units. And we're going to look for just a second, just to kind of get into the groove here about where we're going with this. This, for the math heads in the room, is an anamorphic fractal. And zooming in and out of the whole thing here, and seeing all of these patterns emerging. Patterns. That's the whole fun part about fractals, right? And you totally forgot all this, but stop it. Right, and we get out to the upper bounds, there. And so, you know, you start thinking about where we're going with this today, and well, yeah, it's a little bit cheesy style, but getting into virtual UNIXes, similar things can be done with patterns. And let's see here. So these ideas and stuff that we're going to talk about, like virtualizing machines, these ideas are not at all old. All right. So if you look at the history of UNIX, the entire beginnings of UNIX was a time sharing system, trying to share system resources. Okay. So to me, jailing's a really old idea.
Most computers could be used by just one person running one program. To overcome this inefficiency, so many people could use the machine, time sharing was developed. The obvious next step was to allow each person to run several programs.
UNIX is one of the multi-programming operating systems that now lets each person execute several programs simultaneously. But the usefulness of multi-programming was restricted by the existing terminals. Then the first multi-programming terminal was built.
You
get the idea. So what kind of real-world contexts warrant virtualizing the entire operating system? All right, we have external security threats and development messes, and the same mutually untrusted users. And this is a bunch of hackers at DEF CON's capture the flag competition. Ooh, scary guys, scary guys. Mutually untrusted users, though, aren't always scary guys at hacker conferences. These are mutually untrusted users, and these are the mutually untrusted users that are important to me, and if I'm interpreting the word correctly, these are the mutually untrusted users that are the ones that made jailing in the first place. Why are these people mutually untrusted users? They're all sitting waiting for common shared resources, the subway, and, this guy at the far side here, he's not to be trusted in this woman's kitchen, period. She's not to be trusted with his motorcycle.
conversely. That's just how it is. But everybody, you know, is waiting right here for shared infrastructure. But then again, there are these rooms full of wily hackers for the conferences and they come. All right, so we'll get to some of the users. I hooked up these ladies' website, and I'm telling you, they hired a kid just to recompile Telnet after it. People do dumb stuff in their systems. People, you know, any system administrator in the room knows this. Look at this guy standing on a metal ladder in a swimming pool, barefoot, with an electric drill. All right? You see these scenarios at work, can't we all, right? And people just have habits that are out of control, and you don't understand. People have bad names, you know? It's like, and, you know, mutually untrusted users also have cultural differences that are astounding. Right? In parts of India, rats, I'm told, are, you know, kind of sacred animals and treated very, very well. In New York City, they are not. So, you know what I mean? Like, you want to run PHP MySQL admin? What? Okay, cool. It works for you. And then programs. Programs have all kinds of problems on their own, and they're mutually interested users as well. That's Grace Emlyn and the First School Computer Boat. And then professionals. Professional sysadmins, okay? Muscle memory kills. Who has the most accidents in the room? All of us. We do the worst things. We have the craziest stories to tell about systems we've taken down, don't we? You know? And all of this, when you have shared infrastructure, can be a real problem. I don't know what this means. So how do we solve all of these problems? Right? How do we you know, make sure that everybody steps in line and doesn't create problems for everyone else? Well, America develops very bad. And let me just tell you really quickly that living in this kind of environment is about as much fun as living in really locked down systems, you know, like boxes with high secure levels and all kinds of draconian rules. And people you have to ask before you run a particular binary, you're going to be fired. It's not fun. And, you know, once upon a time, Unix was fun. And I still think Unix is fun, you know? And so all of these are all mutually untrusted users in my world that I care about, all right? I care about letting them have fun and live their lives. I also care about protecting them from each other and themselves. So more practical, okay? Go away from this abstract stuff. And thanks for putting up with that. Maintaining old, junky systems. This is, you know, client system, say, with the, yeah, those are all 1 gigabyte SCSI hard drives. This thing's sucking a lot of power, and it's a big waste. And it's running 3 web servers, a local use DNS cache, a file server that's used by 2 people in this office, and 2 dev servers. Man, stick this all in one little high-density 1U box. You could get another one, and voila, make it redundant. This is pretty cool stuff. Another practical use. I don't know how things are in Europe, but man, in the States, if you're around the data center scene, wow, electricity. Wow, this is scary, man. It's bad. It's getting worse. Power problems. Consolidating hardware is a really great idea. All right. So we'll get to jailing. Quickie little, just had to throw this in, it's kind of out of place, but I thought McElroy, write programs that do one thing and do it well, okay? Jail does this, it's very simple. What is jail? Jail 8, manual section 8, it's a user space utility. Just like ifconfig, produces a virtual system image, it's process tree based. The jail system call is simply the system call that is, you know, calls to root and attaches it to an IP because it's a lot of the chroot code bound to an IP. It's pretty simple. What jail is not, it is not a classical machine emulator. I'll get to that a little bit later, but that's the macho land of computing, you know, like machine emulation. It is not chroot. All right, so a lot of folks in the room, call things jail all the time. It drives me nuts. Just
hard to find stuff with search engines, man.
So jail's jail. Say true. Say true. I'll bribe you with beer. Chill out. Great uses for jail, again, hardware resource sharing. You can securely separate untrusted users and processes. They're great for learning environments. They're great for development environments, testing, hacking new stuff, user land stuff. They're great. You have insane high availability possibilities. Okay, so imagine if your system just sits in the file system and you can start replicating it all over the place. Think of how you would do this. Start going crazy and have fun with it. You can, jails are great for honeypots and highly vulnerable network services. Poor uses for jail. Anything where you need direct kernel access. You don't get a kernel firewalls. Limited network interface access, depending on the context of how you tune the system. Limited device driver access. Poor use for jail. Wouldn't CH root simply do the job. You know, if you're running a name server and you've got all of the mechanisms there to CH root it, ORC, it's pretty much a waste of time to set up jail just to do that. Some applications require particular low-level system calls. Notably, Postgres still doesn't run securely in jails, because it still uses these ridiculous system-wide IPC calls in memory. If anybody wants to talk about that, I can skip it. How to jail. We're going to talk about I'm going to run through as fast as possible how to jail part. Because realistically, a lot of us in the room have done this. I'm going by the man page here. The man page is the definitive manual for jailing. It's short. It's simple. Right? There's no... If anybody writes a really big book about jailing, I don't know, I'm probably lying, but don't want it. Let me see. So what do you do? You compile your user land from source. So you got to get the source code somewhere on the host machine. You create an IP alias on a network interface. Rocket science so far. Run the jail call with the IP user land, and you kind of boot the jail. It's not really booting, but it runs. It starts at RC. It starts where all your starts from start. And a practical comparison again with the diagrams. What's different between these two systems? Well, one's physical hardware, one's virtual, one's got a kernel, one doesn't. There's a device missing on the jailed system. But other than that, pretty much everything. So making a jail from the host machine. This was done with a FreeBSD 6.1 machine, and I didn't redo it for just this time because, well, it's the best version of these slides so far. Pre-flight. So you got to get your source to see this up, whatever. Make somewhere for the jails to live, partitions, disk mounts, whatever. Putting your jail systems at the very least on a separate partition is a very good idea for resource-based disk attacks. So the jail is, you know, uses all of the disk, it doesn't take the whole host system up. Simple little thing. So you just got to make somewhere for your jail-related start management scripts. So I'm going to get to that in a bit. It's thinking about RC. But starting all of your jails, a note here, starting all of your jails at the host system boot time is terrible. If you have problems, you have massive jailed systems, which even if you start out, just run a few small jails, you'll eventually run a lot more. And if you end up having a problem with one of the systems as it starts, boy, you're in for trauma. Getting the whole host back up. So, pre-flight. And by the way, am I going too fast? Am I talking too, Brooklyn-y? Okay. The man page again. Here's this important section about building the jail. Just a few lines. You define the source. Go through this. You define the source, where it's going to live. You make this directory. You go to your source code, you make world, with the destination directory being where you're going to put your jailed systems. And so there we go. And what did we just do? So we've got, I'm going to put this in user local jails. And in user local jails, we just made this directory for our jail. And next thing we're going to do is, what are we going to do? We're going to make, go into the source code, which you can get again, CV is up, FTP, whatever, CV. Make world with our destination directory, and you just let it cook, compile it, and keep going. And you make distribution, destination directory, and you let it cook. So what did we just do? We took that jail, userland directory, and we just populated it with the userland. Cool. Now we're gonna mount the devfs in there. And quick note, I'm just consolidating a lot of parts of this. Mount devfs. You can throw it. Mount devfs is great. Now the devices are mounted instead of built. When you mount it, you can throw all the flags you want in the world to restrict access to specific hardware devices. And to really give the jail access to only what it needs, which if you're really locking down boxes, is a great idea. Doesn't take a lot of time, just takes a little thought. For historical purposes, there's no kernel. So usually in 4.x era, I would assume because nobody knew what would happen if there was nothing called kernel in your root. Is that why there was a soft
I think it needs to see RC issue.
It's an RC issue. Okay. Well, for historical purposes, just put it there.
Leave it as a sign that the hacker has had a big made in the jail.
Right. And at least they can't figure out their jail by running LS. Sorry. Which is effective security amongst a number of those people. So we've got that link. What do? We mounted all of our devices. Common question, why isn't there some automated system built for this stage of the process, right? Shouldn't this just be like, make jail here? Well, there's too many variables in what I just explained that, what if you're building jails all on little slices of your system? What if you're not building them on a particular slice at all? What if you're going to tweak out the your make world with a couple other flags to do something specific? What if? This isn't very hard. That's tough. I didn't answer. And also, again, we've got to configure. We're going to go back to the host machine for a moment, not the jail, and configure a few things. Because in this case, we've got our IP address for a host, and we want a really, really locked down host. We don't want to be running anything on the host, all right? The host is sacred. The host is this place where, your host system should never be rebooted. Your host system is very precious. And let me see, so what else are we going to do? We're going to throw some flags in INMD, obviously bind enable no. We don't want it doing anything. We don't want our master system doing anything. So even SSHD, make sure you lock it down to your host's IP address. IP addresses that are only going to be used on your host system. Only. Why? Because you don't want SSH listening on, what about your SSH listens for the host and for your jailed systems. When your system doesn't have SSH on. So those are that's about as crazy as you get, locking down your host system. Beyond that, you want to use the most extreme secure practices that you know to run your host system. You don't want to use it for anything. I'm a big fan of seeing login screens on my hosts that don't fill up my terminal, after a month, because that place is not a place to play. Your jails are, you can have all kinds of problems here. Okay, so next, from the man page, we're going to run the jail command manually, all right? And all we do is just tell it where it lives, give it a host name, tell it the IP address, and run a shell. And this is kind of analogous to booting the machine in super user mode. Sort of. So you run through this little list of things that are in the man page, and where are we at? Yes. Get our host name. I'm going to do this real fast, but it's just like setting a new system. Add users. Set our time zone.
And we're going to look at src.conf, sshd is enabled. We're also going to toss in and send emails to mid enabled. That's just a personal thing I like. But really, really good jail
RPC bind enable no network interfaces, none, just so you don't get any errors marking your logs. IMP enable no NFS with your portal, yes, that's all in the man page, it's real simple. So what do we just do?
We've got our user land devices, the DevNo kernel, and we just add users, we modify RC scripts, whatever's going to be happening.
We're finished configuring the jailed system. We assign it an IP address, bring up the IP address, and let me see, I'm going to mount proc fest. This is like just a full manual, how we try to do it. Bring up proc fest in the jail, which again will only show the processes running in the jail to the jailed users and the jailed root users. And we've added our network interfaces. And here's a star tangent. Let me see. We start the jail manually. This is a little movie of starting. And make their keys. Does everybody know what this looks like in the room? Everybody's seen this kind of action? I mean, just installing a base system? Anybody install FreeBSD in the room? Okay, cool. That's what I did. The system has now started. So we just finished starting our jail system. Now what do we do with it? Well, SSH, we configured SSH so that it's running. And we can SSH into the jails. We can also list the JLS utility, SD5 onward, to list the jails available. And then using the jail, SSH into the jail and to that pool. You treat it just like it's a running live server. If you're mucking about a lot, I'm just going to say a quick aside, which I'm going to hit over and over again in small moments as we continue. If you muck about in the jail from your host server, you're bound to run into all kinds of terrible, terrible problems. Not just with mucking up your jail system, but messing around with your host. Okay. So if you say, how many FreeBSD users in the room know what /home actually is? Anybody? Or what? User local home. Too early. So with that stated, if you're trouncing into a jailed system, muscle memory kills, right? So if you trounce into a jailed system and go into home, that's going to be a soft link to home under root directory. In there and delete a huge number of things, in your host system's home directory. Right? Why does that user exist there? What am I doing? Create all kinds of confusion. So you really want to SSH into it and live in it from the outside. Let me see here. So in the jail, and it's just like any new server. Yep, there's all of our running processes. Note, there's a bunch of things missing. Like, where's the init? Oh, I don't know. And wow, our process IDs start awful high. Well, that's what it looks like. You're running inside the jail right now. You also have root in your jail. And as the jailed root user, I mean, you really are root. Really, pros. And so how do you know you're inside the jail? This control has this full of tunable variables. It also has this variable that tells you whether or not you are jailed or are not jailed on the FreeBSD system. Bottom of this slide is a URL, which you'll get later, for a patch if you for some reason or another want to, you know, have that always be where not, if you want it to always be zero, you're not going to do it. So starting and stopping the jail. So we exit jail, and what are we doing next? Okay, so let's look at the jail process. These are like really, you know, simple man page things. They're all in the jail man page, say about getting around jails. There's ways to list all of these, a number of processes by jail ID. Let me see. These are all jail processes. You're going to kill a jail. You want to stop a jail. How do you do it? Well, at this point, use kill all with the dash J flag and the jail ID. And that's all there is to it. If you're using this in FreeBSD 4, which I bet there's people in the room that might need this on 4.x, this is a correction. These scripts, there's a fistful of little utilities that are really great in ports. And another little gotcha, watch out for stacking mount points. All right, because mount points aren't like, using mount isn't like ifconfig, where you can run ifconfig and add that alias as many times as you bloody want, and it will always just be that one IP address and one IP alias. Whereas mount points, you can start stacking inside of jail, and it's just, I throw this in here because it's really common to see people doing this all the time. Let me see what else. Restarting, and it's also been common over the years, little glitches and little bugs if you're starting and stopping jails from the RC scripts, that as well will always mount or unmount your mount points in the jail. So, RC scripts have had problems. So we're going to restart the jail with a little simple start script, and there it goes. The jail is started. Pretty simple. Okay. And let me see. If you look at this, the jail ID, which is the column we were talking about looking for before, BS output, jail ID has now changed to 6. And jail ID 4 is 5, which is what I made a couple of times. JLS has a little glitchy bug in it where if you kill a jail, sometimes the process, the jail will still keep itself listed in the list as though it's running. It's a little bit of an annoyance. If you really need to know for sure that the jail's processes are dead, you can just start ripping through the PropFS tree or start ripping through the PS output. Some scripts that you can build with, which is important out of the way for the coordination. So, if JExec, okay, I'm going to talk for a second about JExec. JExec is really handy in a situation, it's actually tremendously useful in a situation where most of your mutually entrusted users are programs. Okay? If you're consolidating a number of servers from a trusted network, if you're consolidating systems such as jail systems in a trusted environment, pretty much what the reason you're jailing them is that you are trying to separate processes or various types of environments from each other, not necessarily human users. Now, JExec, what it does is it spawns a process that attaches to the jail inside of the jail. So you throw, it's like, you know, using sudo, okay? You say, you know, JExec, the jail ID, and then pass a command, and the command runs inside the jail. So, doing this from the host, okay, why is JExec a bad idea? Well, anecdotal story. Jails were used for capture the flag at DEF CON 1, 2, 3 years ago. With great success, the first time they used a virtualized environment. And is anybody in the room familiar with the capture the flag competition? It's neat. It's kind of a war games. For those of you who aren't, it's a network war games environment that happens at the DEF CON conference in Las Vegas. And it's pretty hardcore. There's just some of the craziest people on the planet know a lot about system exploits. And in this battle, jails were used with great success. And suddenly, they could do all of these things to really tightly monitor scoring. in ways they never have before. Every team is given a server to protect, and then they have to go attack all of the rest of the other team's servers. There's tons of different ways to score points. So in this environment, the jailed systems meant that they had, for the first time, people running the capture the flag competition had a god's eye view of the entire battlefield. Okay? They could look in directories, see what's going on. They could take process samples and see what's running, what's not running, what's how it's running. They could do all kinds of fun things. Except immediately, this was a surprise to me in talking with one of the organizers on this one. Immediately, they ran into a problem with all of their scripts that they had run with JXI. They had built all of these scoring tools that were really sophisticated with JXI. They would dip into the jails, do something, and then pop back out with results that they would process and throw into a database for scoring. Immediately, all of the contestants, everybody in the competition figured out what was going on because they'd see this really strange process that they couldn't quite see or figure out how it was attaching or what was going on, or they'd see some process they were using hang for a split second. It would be a glitch in the matrix, right? And so immediately, all of the jailed participants in the competition made all kinds of scripts to start immediately killing everything that came in, like Indiana Jones tunnel style. You know, so here comes JXAC in the hand of the Gordon tools, and boom! As soon as the hand goes in, it cut it right off. So that was interesting to see that just from a practical perspective, how quickly everybody adapted to this. So JXAC's pretty bad. In this case, you gotta do things to go back into the system really with SSH. If you're running really, if you have systems that are really, truly compromised, you don't want to be running JXAC. You can't really, you're attaching a process that is somehow directly connected to the host machine to the jail. All right, there's a lot of attack service. It's basically, you know, this is the situation you have. You know, which guy, which bomb guy do you want to be? All right, if you're going to go in and you're going to, you know, figure out the, and you know, disarm this bomb, you want to be the guy who's twiddling with the wires, or do you want to be the guy with the robot that drives it down the street and blows it up? All right. Let me see. The gap propagated status contains the last field, et cetera, et cetera. More process stuff. So what we've gotten from this is that practical comparison for running applications, your host and your jail are pretty much identical. Here's pictures of like the process tree again with the diagram. So here's the whole host server in PropFS. The jail only sees the processes that it's allowed to see. Okay, and PropFS here, we at the end of the processes, proc ID, and then status, at the very end of the file here, you'll see the host name of the jail that owns that jail process, which for the host server, you don't see anything. You get a dash. Okay? And shouldn't be highlighted, but the little J at the end will be status or PS output, so you know that the process is jailed. Does everybody get it? Does anybody have any questions before we proceed on? Okay. So, some best practices stuff and pattern stuff and opportunities. So, like I said, you want to use your highest secure practices for your host server. All right? You want to know a lot about SSH. All right? If you're running a real production service on the net, you want to have a contingency plan for what happens when SSH has a bad day for all of us. Okay? You want to always see the jailed file system in user land. You can always see the jailed file system from in user land from the host server, but again, be careful. Symlinks and all kinds of other little pitfalls await you. Design your jailing system carefully, which just means remember where you put stuff. Remember where you put all your jail systems. And be creative with core Unix utilities. Because really, you know, in a stock BSD install, and you have such an amazing tool chest to work with jail systems. You don't need any external tools. You don't need any jail system, any specific jailing things from the courts. Everything you need to really run great jail systems is just right there in the source, meaning the base system. Again, like I said, in 4.x FreeBSD, we have JPS, JKill, and JTalk. So they're jail versions of all of what they describe. And five and six onward, they're built into PS and KILL, like you saw. Plus JLS, JEXEC, JATACH. Design your jailing system carefully. Note about NullFS and DevFS. Well, that's kind of gone a little bit past that. Additionally, handy, PS trees can be useful. Xtail is really, really useful. I just like it. Disk images via ND. And I know I just told you guys the base system is great. There's Xtail for jail systems. Okay, so common weak points in a Unix system. Let me see, lost jail, hostname lockdown, resource attacks, the disk being full of partitions, disk images are great ways to mitigate that problem. Fork bombs and memory hogs, secure levels and login.conf, which we'll get to in a second. How are we doing on time, you guys? If anybody needs to or wants to leave for lunch, start getting hungry, feeling like it. I understand you. Let me see. Process controls. Direct driver access flags to mount DevFS and PropFS, like I talked about before. There's really nothing about all of these weak points in jailing that's really that different than any Unix system. All right, you have to deal with these problems on any system that you're running to face the internet. That faces any possible network or any friendly network with problems. Really the only difference between securing a jail system and a regular system in this context is the hostname lockdown. If a jail user changes their hostname and is allowed to, you're going to have a really hard time fumbling around in the host trying to find what processor is actually what, especially in. Once you have more than as many jails as you can have vendors. So some comments on isolation, memory and process attacks. There was a guy named Everett Cervanto who solved this great problem that he found. He ran a thing called the Open Root Project years ago. It was a jail system, and on a web page, the root login credentials were posted, and every hour on the hour, jail had a tarball dumped over the top of it and restarted every hour on the hour. And what a neat project. So this was open to the world. You could do whatever you wanted with this jail system. And the guy wrote a great paper that was in Sysinfo magazine. The URL's here. It's around the net. You copy here and there. And about how to mitigate the one problem as everybody was using these systems to try to break it. And he found that was fork bombs, all right? So he found that, the combination of upping your secure levels, setting a immutable bit on login.conf, you can actually really pretty sanely deal with fork bombs. He wrote this great paper about it, describing how to do it. It was all very thoughtful, very simple. And at the end of the paper, I read, Everett Cervanto's a 14-year-old, social junior high school. Great. And I realized, wow, this guy just trained a bunch of junior high school American Unix terrorists for like a year. Awesome. This is cool. So anyways, that was a really neat project. And it's gone for now. It's been gone for a while. Here's it's not a CD. There's no CD. Make sure this is available for everybody. Really simple piece of code that a friend of mine, Brian Redman, wrote. He's used it to break just about every system in the world since 1986 when he wrote it. And it's called hog, and you pass hog in a simple utility, you pass hog in user, and it consumes that much memory in megabytes. Real simple. So down at the bottom here, you've got the simplest fork bomb that you could possibly make. And this is a great tool for stress testing all kinds of systems. Memory limits, look, memory and process limits and process controls, these are always really, really difficult problems in the computer. You know? It really doesn't matter. A good friend who's been working a lot with Solaris buildings and told me great things and also told me there's heavy trade-offs and penalties for being able to control memory and processes. So these are still really hard problems to solve. And just as an aside, the guy who wrote this little teeny piece of code, you know, he's been working with really big systems for a very, very, very long time. And so this is really neat little tool. So with memory and process attacks, here's the recipe for the lockdown, step by step. The first step, you simply edit login.conf and lock down all of your maximum processes, maximum memory use. Second step, you make sure you've set immutable flags on the jailed system's login.conf. And then, ta-da, in step three, you set a higher secure level for the jailed system. That's all there is to it. Honeypots. This has got the patch again so that your jailed systems can be as zero. Disk resource control. So you want to at least put your jailed systems on sets of separate partitions. If you're trying to separate everybody in separate partitions, just from practice, this can get really, really, really cumbersome. Not only do disk IO, where the actual heads moving from partition to partition, bogging things down, but when you need to make a jailed system's disk larger, it's really, really inflexible. File-back disk images are terrific. They're really, really flexible. They're excellent tools in terms of controlling disk consumption. But you've got severe disk IO penalties. Okay? And disk IO right now with jailed systems, and I think with a lot of systems, realistically, is the biggest bottleneck that you face. So again, there's trade-offs for every step you take to secure your system. File back disk to convenient. And here's how to do file back disks, but I'm going to skip it because it's in the FreeBSD handbook. And let's see, automation. Okay, tarball packaging is really the simplest way to go about everything, automating, moving systems from server to server, backing systems up. It's simple, it's reliable. You gotta be aware of your dev and prod bounds, be aware of siblings, but tar is fantastic. And you can also use the FreeBSD ports mechanism. You've never been in an environment, but it's always something that's been talked about. Like, wow, it would be really great for us to use the ports mechanism, not to put a jailed system in the ports, that's silly, but to run our own jailed systems from ports. So that suddenly we say, hey, we want the Apache web server jailed system for blog project. Push button, it's running. Automated that way. Or we want the Light HTTPD server, Lighty server for this project, because this developer wants that. Push the button, it's running. You could also use CVS and SVN. And for a time at a web hosting company that I was part of, I mean, we actually used CVS for a number of changes that we did for the jails that we rolled out to our customers. Upgrading jailed systems. Simply use build world from the host system. And toss the build world the destination directory flag with the jails userland path, and it's pretty darn simple. Editing syscontrol.com. The recipe. So here's all the defaults, and let me see if there's anything really noteworthy to talk about. Really. Buttons and knobs for controlling jails. Set host name allowed. Let me see. The default's one, which allows jailed users to reset their host name, which can be useful in some contexts. But again, for running massive jailed systems, that's your first line of massive confusion. Security jail force status. This is to deal with not.
So in a jailed system, you can show all the mount points on the host. You can show no mount points whatsoever. Or you can show just the mount points that are mounted within the jail secure zone.
You also have allower on sockets,
so things like ping now, the new and before that.
You can, allow access to router sockets. Here's the system 5 IPC call. You know, I'm not sure who wrote this in, but because of Postgres' popularity, this was written in to allow system 5 IPC calls for jailed systems. That meets your environmental requirements, that's great. Go, run Postgres. Otherwise, you don't need to run system 5 IPC. Unless your application calls for it. Security, jail change flags allowed. Okay, and you can use that right there to lock down your login.conf so that the jail root can't do anything with the, or they can't change flags on a file and modify.
So there's the stock values
again.
Firewalls, quick comment. This is an often asked question.
I can't run a firewall in my jail. What's the problem?
Yeah, you don't have access to the kernel.
And boy, it would be really neat if I could have a PF, perhaps, or something in a virtualized sense, be able to only manage given IP addresses. Network socket. But that's not there. So all firewalling needs to be done from the host server. But again, really, what are you doing with your jails, right? Because in many situations, where people say, oh, that's stupid, why do you overrun firewall? Well, if you're running a web server, some kind of web server naming, the only port they're going to have open from the jails might be SSH and a web server. You'd be able to control these values and maybe do more advanced things to the packets and the traffic. A lot of that is not going to fall in the hands of application developers that use the systems. So as much as it would be really nice to be able to manage firewalls from the jail system, so that maybe it would be great to run spam B from jail systems. That'd be awesome. But right now, it's just not possible. Maybe as all these things mature, get there. Let me see, start script, disk image. Okay, starting from rc.dok, I promise I would say something about this. Look, for years, I haven't wanted to use the rc.e scripts, mostly because everybody tends to use them when the system is booted, it's booting, which is a really difficult idea in a massively jailed system. I'm telling you from experience, running things you would never expect. And then second, they had a number of weird bugs and answered lots of questions for people, but I never really pursued any of these bugs. I never really used them. Until, ta-da, recently a security vulnerability was the URL sphere. Security vulnerability basically was that at mount, you had some super tricky bad little symlinks here and there that replaced other devices to execute code on the host machine. Bad. That's very bad. So that when the system starts, suddenly you're executing code from the jail and the host, and the root host. Game over for everybody. So that's kind of bad. And so there's a bunch of new useful stuff in the jail RC scripts, which at the moment I'm looking at personally. I'm not committed to it personally. But it looks pretty good. It just checks for all of these bad symlinks. I don't know if this is a good strategy, because these RC scripts continue down this kind of path of thinking can get really, really bloated and complex, and I've found them buggy over the years in the first place. So, I don't know. If anybody has any comments about that, fuck you. If anybody thinks I'm wrong, come hit me. Let me see. I won't get back unless you're really wrong. Okay, that's about enough about the RC scripts for the moment. Jailing cron tab miscellany. To the side, cron will yell about a couple of things. If you don't comment them out. Let me see. Miscellaneous gotcha. Can't delete the jailing directory? Haha! This is just a bunch of immutable flags set, 6-bit set, various directories. So you clear all of that, and you can delete the jailing directory.
asked,
help, what's wrong with this laptop? What am I supposed to do?
No. How's everybody doing for hungry and for time? Should I continue on, or should I at the regular pace, or should I just
go on
slam on? Okay. True virtual machines, all right? And people don't really know what a true virtual machine is. It's software that emulates hardware both. And if anybody hasn't been sleeping through this talk so far, you realize that that's not what jailing's about whatsoever. Jailing is about containment, okay? And granularly being able to adjust your containment based on your needs, not running a virtual machine. But virtual machines, again, they are the macho place in computing because in software you are remaking computers. This is tough stuff. And some of the work that's done is absolutely brilliant. So I definitely not making fun of virtual machines. However, in the context of having web-facing production servers, not the best idea in the world for a lot of reasons. All right, look at VMware, we look at these models. We point at this screen, we point at this screen. We look at the model, the virtual machine wrapper around our operating system, whatever operating system we can run on this virtual hardware. So we've got, what is it? Windows, Linux. And then we've got our applications on top of it. We've got a lot of overhead, as you can see. There's a lot more parts to this puzzle to manage, which as you scale this out to say having, 100 virtual machines on this one piece of hardware, this becomes a very, very complex system, which I see as being very negative. Unless you like twiddling bits when you should be eating dinner, other things. And that's all running on top of some base operating system. Whereas in FreeBSD with jails, you're running processes inside one system, right? So this is the kind of fundamental functional difference here. And some negative parts of it are, hey, you know, like developer headcount on these projects, closed source, not as many people using it, not as many people seeing it, testing it, breaking it. And to be really straight, the same things that really need to be broken to fundamentally destroy jail are chroot and TCP/IP sockets. Those two things are fundamentally compromised or have some fundamental vulnerability. A lot of people in the world who don't care about jailing are going to be caring. Okay? That's really important. It's really important. Okay? Some zones are very, very nice. And in the words of some of the Sun developers, when they're not being swatted down by marketing guys, shut up. You know, it really came directly out of FreeBSD's jail mechanism, to my knowledge, and some mumblings and murmurs from some people who really said that it was inspiring to them. Some zones, they've gone nuts. They've got all kinds of interesting extra bonus things, and there are lots and lots of features. Like, at this point, memory and process limits, that are interesting, and I don't know a lot about it, or have any hands-on experience with it. Anybody who does in the room, I'd love to hear about it in the chat. Cool. Hit them while we're eating, drinking. So, like I said, we refer to FreeBSD jail as an equivalent idea. the user land utility search try to be similar. And the Sun put these custom inner zone IPC into Solaris because a lot of their market that wanted this, financial guys who go, you know, we've got too many servers, our bills are too high, and all this stuff were just very simple things. It's consolidated, and they have all these trading applications, and developers go, wow, it's in the same hardware. If we had some inner jail IPC, we could do some more efficient communication and not use the network as much. Okay, cool. That's all great when you're, you know, constraining programs. Usually entrusted users, but it's an attack vector as well, okay? And I believe, you know, it's true of more able to be turned off, you know, so I'm not really trying to pick at it. And developer headcount's another issue again. Secure closed source, it's not an open source. Let's look at Zen. This is a big one. And I don't want to really fight with anybody except, you know, fun ones, barring. But, you know, Zen's got a number of issues. Again, it's got a complexity issue where it's just a far more complex system from the get-go. Running the Zen hypervisor, running the operating system, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, if we look at attack vectors here, we've got, again, these demand IDs, we've got the partitioned memory process in I.O., we've got the hypervisor itself, which is an attack vector compared to chroot and TCP/IP sockets. I tend to trust the blue ones. Let me see. So attack vectors again, developer headcount. Man, there's all these things with Zen that drive me a little bit nuts. Developers love it. Hardware vendors love Zen. And this kind of weirds me out because knowing a bit about the history of virtual machines, there have been so many that have come and gone and just died over in the history of computing. Why? Well, vendors don't like it because if you have virtual machines, you buy less hardware. So it hit me really weirdly. Why do vendors like Zen so much? Why does IBM, of all people, love Zen so much? If anybody works for IBM, I'm sorry. They really like this stuff. Well, there's a number of things. Because suddenly now they when this slide was created, they were making specific hardware tweaks for the hypervisor that were IBM only, one good way to sell more stuff. And this top secret VT CPU, which was Intel's idea, put all this hypervisor stuff right into the CPU. And does anybody know much about cracking web? Like, throwing things like this into hardware is just a bad idea, because now we've got an attack vector we've got something to attack that's really hard to change. It's hardware, it's deployed. Another company, Triangle of France, made an embedded hypervisor as well. And, there's one more issue. Oh yeah, 2 gigabyte physical memory on the host machines, all that Zen can use. Wow, it's 2007. Until a lot of these issues are resolved or at least addressed, and I've asked developers who are very close to the Zen community if there's been anybody who's addressed this, and so far all I've seen is a lot of let's not talk about that. So it's just something real, I don't really care too much about it. And now you got even Microsoft, Microsoft is jumping into the mix and embracing the hypervisor. Not an exciting sign for me, personally. And here's, an immediate exploits for hardware-software combos that haven't even been released in the world. This was just a few days ago. Cisco and VMware buddy up for V-Frame Data Center, and they're pushing all this Zen stuff again, too. There's all this stuff in here that's just making me scratch my head going, what's the game? I don't get it. We're already doing this stuff. We're an ISP that was very, very, from a user perspective, business perspective, very successful with open source tools. And we're a heck of a lot more sophisticated than some of the stuff that's about to be sold. So 64 gigs of memory on Intel machines using VA. Think also about this, all these different other architectures that are able to be supported, all the Zen stuff, it's x86. I don't know about you guys, but I'm kind of mind of doing this since I was a little kid. Since I was a little kid, I've seen lots of CPUs come and go, whether I knew a lot about their internals or not, but I'm not a real believer that Intel's going to be around in 10 years in the same way it is now. In Words on a True VM from HK standing right over there, I found a cool lecture that he gave on this exact topic that, quote, people love lousy virtualization. And I just laughed out loud. That exactly echoes my thoughts, because it's not mucho macho real virtual machines. Darn, it's great. And future directions, disk I.O., bigger disks, more disks, network disks, disk, DFS, disks, anything having to do with disk. Also, anybody who's interested in doing work with carbon field systems for failover, love to talk with you about all kinds of field hacking.
mostly from user land to try and play with this stuff. And I've found some interesting things at the point it's called Vanilla. And more suggested reading. Jill's confining the omnipotent root. It's exactly the content of my lecture, just better with less pictures. And, you know, done this once before. We've done this two of them. In New York, or through Nice Folk, done these jamming parties, which is kind of like the open root thing, where we get a box and start on a Friday night and everybody gets root on this box who's talking to me in advance, and we all make jails and set aside a bunch of free cloud binaries and all bog the machine down, just compiling user land. And we go to town. Everybody just jails, makes jails, screws around with jails. And by the end of the weekend, hopefully we've destroyed everything. And it's a lot of fun and lots of learning. So if anybody's interested in putting another one of these together somewhere, I would be totally into helping make it happen. It's a lot of fun, and even if you don't want to learn about jails, well, just having systems that you can destroy with a bunch of people on IRC to talk to about what you're doing is really a lot of fun. So we're at the end, and lunch is on its way here. Special thanks. Learning Reality, my main crew, great friends. PHK, and Robert Watson, of course, for writing jail. And boy, this is, here's a bunch of logos and fun stuff. These are a bunch of different crews that are very, very important to me. Of course, your BSDCon, the Danish UNIX User Group, BSDDK. You guys, thank you so much for having us all here. This is such a terrific opportunity to share. And mostly, special thanks to all the mutually untrusted users out there. Okay? So I'll make sure that the links and hog is on the USB thingamajig in a while later on. And there'll also be the lecture notes will be posted at the Nice Bug on our website in the library as well, just in case. And I'm Ike, and I really appreciate that all of you have to do all of that very much. Really, Joey Hunt.
Just one second.